Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. As anyone who reads the New York Times daily, you know that there is a columnist named Maureen Dowd, and she pulls no punches. She often is the epitome of the pen is definitely mightier than the sword, and there are many balloons that have been deflated. But she has written a new book called Are Men Necessary? When Sexes Collide, and it's published by Penguin and Putnam. Welcome, Maureen.
Thank you, Connie.
And, of course, first question anyone says, are men necessary? And they would have to look to your blessed mother.
My mom died this past July. I'm still devastated about it. But before she died, she said to me, can't you change the title to Why Men Are Necessary, period, full stop. She loved men. She loved women too, but she really loved men. And she was worried the title might throw people off. And I said, you know, I explained it was a play on the old Thurber White, Is Sex Necessary? Mm-hmm. And which was a satire about sex and trying to understand women. So I wanted to do the same thing for men.
And it also is a play on Sigmund Freud's What Do Women Really Want?
My girlfriend, Jill Abramson, the managing editor of the Times, was watching The Lady Eve with Barbara Stanwyck and Henry Fonda last night. And it's one of my favorite movies, and I quote from it in the book because it has that great 40s banter between men and women, or it might have been 30s. But she reminded me that Henry Fonda, who was, you know, had left his family ale business and had become an expert in reptiles, when he gets back from Africa and he's on the cruise boat, he's reading a book called Are Snakes Necessary? So it's a play on all kinds of things.
The first 84 pages, though, are really on the women of today.
Right.
The women who didn't marry right out of college. Women are getting married much later than they were when you were a senior in school and first thing you did on Sunday was to see who's engaged.
Right. What is that line on Sex and the City? They said the New York Times wedding listings were like the sports pages for women.
And the other part is the women going on dates and still expecting men to pick up the check. No going Dutch.
Right. They think going Dutch is, as one young woman put it to me, a scuzzy 70s thing, like platform shoes on men. Well, that's part of what got me interested in writing the book, because I hadn't realized until a couple years ago that young women expect to be paid for on a first date, which was one of the major tenets of feminism when I was dating in the 70s, that you always had to pony up your half because you did not want, you wanted to break that centuries-old contract of trading your beauty or, you know, femininity.
How about sex?
Yes, or that the guy would expect to, you know, have sexual favors in return for paying for mm-hmm. you. And so that was something that feminists were very adamant about. And when I realized girls had gone back, now young women want to be assessed on their sexuality. They want the guy to declare by paying for the dinner that they find her sexually attractive. And also in an age of hookups and hanging out where it's hard to tell what's really a date, they use it as a signal that the guy is really interested.
But the other side of that coin is I have many feminine friends who have ended up after the marriage and it didn't work, and they were earning the same or maybe a little more than the man. They are still paying alimony.
Oh, that's so funny.
So, I mean, that's the other side.
Give me their numbers. I'll put them in the paperback.
All right. But not funny to them.
Yeah.
Because no children, nothing. And the judge says, in essence, you want equality? That's where you're going to pay, baby.
Well, this is one of my favorite terms in the book. A woman who was dating in her early 30s in New York said that guys were starting to refer to girl money a couple years ago, like when they would pick up the check, the guys would say, you keep your girl money, I'll pay for it.
Yeah.
You know, so everything was flipped around from when feminism first started, including the fact that Mrs. now, which Gloria Steinem fought so hard to get rid of in the New York Times, and if you were single, to allow yourself to be called Ms. And Abe Rosenthal finally agreed in 1986, and I was there that day, and Gloria Steinem sent him flowers the day he agreed to it. And now Mrs. is the ultimate status symbol for Ivy League women, for young women. They wear these spangly t-shirts, they get a Kitson's with Mrs. Clooney, Mrs. Pitt.
Yeah, and the other is, years ago, Mary, who was working at Bendix, and she said, oh, we never had an affair going. Of course, they later got married, and she is sitting in the miniskirt up to her crotch. It's my mother, and I'm sure your mother would have said, what does she expect?
Well, that was one of my favorite all-time lines. Michael Kinsley, in a column, wrote about that, you know, coupling. He said that Bendix leaned her across the desk and mentored her till dawn.
Yeah. And now we get to the Y chromosome and the fact of women having children. Do you need that sperm?
Well, I think that all of this is done in a very wry, tongue-in-cheek way, of course, because the Y won't. There were two books by British geneticists out last summer that said that the Y is rotting and it may go out of business in 100,000 years. And so it's all done in a very tongue-in-cheek way. And one of the evolutionary biologists has this funny line about how the Y married up and the X married down, because the X is stronger as a chromosome, and they're discovering it has a lot more expression than the Y. And David Page, this evolutionary biologist, describes the Y as sort of a slovenly guy in his armchair, and he's waiting for his wife or girlfriend to come in. He's surrounded by empty pizza takeout boxes, and he's waiting for the wife or girlfriend to come in and make the doctor's appointment for him. And that's where, in an evolutionary sense, their chromosome stands. And but it's the opposite of what's happening in life, because then oftentimes men are still marrying down and women are trying to marry up.
Which includes a quote here from Ivana Trump, where she talks about she doesn't mind Donald being married this time and having the baby, although she has certainly passed menopause on the Monopoly game of life. She did mind Mala.
Well, you know, it's funny because one of my sources for the book, Patty Wexler, who's a dermatologist in New York, used Donald Trump as an example the other day. And he said when he was married to Ivana, Ivana was always trying to get in on the business and, you know, compete in business with him and do her own thing. And that Melania just revolves around Donald, and that he seems happier that way. So it's, you know, it's part of the whole thing. Are men and women happier if someone's revolving around them, rather than what we thought, which was the Tracy Hepburn equal, you know, sexy charge banter?
And yet in real life, no one ever waited on anyone as much as she did on Tracy.
Exactly. That is such an amazing thing. And I quote from her autobiography, that was so sad to me. I had to stop watching Hepburn Tracy movies for a while after that, because it made me so sad when she wrote in her autobiography, Me, she said, I had to change every quality I liked about myself. I had to try and squelch because he didn't like them. So the whole country fell in love with all these wonderful, strong, sexy characteristics of hers, except the man she loved, and she tried to change herself for him.
You write about Hillary and Hillary Clinton, and later that there may be a Hillary versus Condi. And yet the two strongest women, to my mind, in this country are Barbara and Laura Bush.